שבוע טוב. מוצאי שבת נוח. Outside there is a very significant rain, Baruch Hashem. In Israel tonight they started to bless ותן תלו מטר לברכה. It's a winter time. And I would like to pray Hashem should give a lot of rain to Israel, בעזרת השם. אז הפרנסה טובה to the entire world. וסבא את העולם כולו מטווח. When you say, מלא ידינו מברכותיך, the first letter is מים. ומושר מתנות ידיך is מים too. So we ask from Hashem, שיש שנה גשומה לברכה בעזרת השם. In פרשת נוח, we read today about three major events that is important to us. There was the flood that came and destroyed the entire world. There is the case of building a tower, the tower of Babylon. And the last event, which is in the last few words of the parasha, but I think is the most important one, is the birth of Avraham Avinu Alav Shalom. And I believe that when we arranged the parashiyot, it was important to put in this parasha the fact that there is Avraham Avinu too, because the first two events resembles about a problem that took place after the world was created. Adam HaRishon, we learned last week, you remember, about the snake and about Adam v'Chava, but it was something individual to people. But Noach talks about something which belongs to the entire nation, to the entire population. As we say, כי השחית כל בשר את דרכו על הארץ. Or we say, בגדל בבל, let's say, let's join the entire people together under one name. Not talking about individual, we're talking about an event on a national, base, on a worldwide base. The Gemara in Masechet Sanhedrin, page 108, interesting. Stova Smoy talk about Dora Mabul. About, they say, Tanu Rabbanan, Dora Mabul, En Laim Chelek Leolam Abba. And talk about the generation of people in time of the flood, and they say that they don't have Olam Abba. They are questioning, not this world, not next world, they even don't come when the Mashiach will come. And they... And Rabbi Yosei in the Gemara try to understand what was their problem. Why did it become so evil? When they were so corrupted, how the Torah says ki shchit, what was the problem? Amar Rabbi Yosei, Dor HaMabul, the generation of the flood, lo nitgau, it was a problem of ego. Ela bishvil galgal ha'ayin shedome lemaim. Talking about eyes problem. Not necessarily eye doctor problem. Talk about overly something that you see and you want. If it belongs to you, doesn't belong to you, you can afford it, you cannot afford it. You saw it and you wanted it. Then ikra galgal ein. And they say because, you know what is in Hebrew, the word ein? Besides being an eye. You know, if there is a whale, the nikra ein, whale, like be'er, ein, ma'ayan, me'ayin. And what is this? It's something that is adding up water from underground all the time, underflow, yes? So the eye is the only element in the body that every time become water are being created over here. So the eye in the eye and the water are very close. So Merabi say that the sin was the eye, so the punishment was the water. Because it's the same thing, Ayin, Ein HaMayim, Ma'ayan, everything is the same concept. But we say, that because the eye saw, and because the heart wanted, then they took off all the restriction, and they became very dangerous. The Gemara continues and asks a question. Men, they have the freedom of choice. Animals do not have. Why God destroyed the animals too? And they say, they bring over here Mashal, that there was a big man that he had a son's wedding. And he made a lot of food and a lot of kind of dishes in the wedding. Before the wedding, lo aleinu, his son died. So, amad upizer et chupato. Amar klum asiti ela bishvil banai. Achshav shemet chupa lamali. The mashal is like this: if something happened to the chatan, lo aleinu, and to the kala, what to do with all the food? He doesn't need it anymore. Why? Because he lost interest in this. The purpose of everything was just for the sake of the human being. Af HaKadosh Baruch Hu Amar klum barati be'ema v'chaya ela bishvil adam. Achshav she'adam chata be'ema v'chaya lama li. If the man made a sin, why do I need the entire world for? God created the world for whom? For us. So if we made a mistake, all the world doesn't mean anything. So Hashem had to destroy it. And this is the, basically we talk about desires, which is not, you know, something we know it, and we as human beings we can understand it. Somebody has 1,000, he wants million, he has million, he wants 10 million. Somebody has this, he wants to eat this. It's something that we can relate to. But we have to see from here that when a person is making a sin, he doesn't hurt just himself. He can hurt the entire world. And I gave you an example once. There was a big factory with 1,000 of workers, and each of them has to make his own item, his own part, in order to continue this. So one of them made a mistake and didn't do it. So the damage wasn't his local problem. The damage was the entire fabric, the entire project. Didn't go through. Why? Because one individual. So if the owner say, hey, you made a mistake, okay, so take donor from $10. I said, not $10, it's $1 million. The chain is broken. I was thinking when I was reading about it, how would Hashem call it chupa? For HaKadosh Baruch Hu, everything is like a wedding. Adam, Chava, we in this world, and the world is like, all the world is like one big chupa, like a big wedding hall. And God wants them to enjoy it. The question is, we don't like to enjoy it. We'd like to find all kind of defaults. One of the halachot of the Torah, it says, "Be'alacha memzayin be'milot la'aseh of the Rambam." Is hiranu, there is a mitzvah, not latur, not to go after our hearts and our eyes. Okay? Meaning, אומר, מה זה נקרא after my eyes? אומר רשי, אומר הרמב״ם, זהו זנות. שנאמר, שמשון told to his father, take this girl because I like her. not because she's good, not because Hashem wants. What is the reason is? I like it. Very interesting. In English, I means I, you know? I like it. אז הוא אומר, לא תתורו אחרי עיניכם. רוצה לומר, יימשך אחר התאוות הגשמיות ויתעסק המחשבה בהן. Somebody will come and tell me that he had argument with his wife that she didn't make enough food on, or we tell him, hey, ולא תתורו אחרי עיניכם. Food is not an issue. How many dish, how many meat, how many fish, you know? This is not the issue. So even the esek of them, it's a problem. Not to follow אחרי התאוות הגשמיות. This is very simple, and this we spoke many times, and this you know, and you know how much it's difficult that you see something and you want it, and Hashem is telling you no, and you say, why not? And this we learned for a long time, and I don't want to focus because I want to go to the other part of the parasha, of which makes a lot of... which is very difficult to understand. The Torah says, the Gemara says, in Masechet Sanhedrin, as I told you before, about Dor HaPalaga. What does it mean, Palaga in Hebrew, you know? Lepaleg is to separate. אז אומרת הגמרא, דור הפלגה, אין להם חלק לעולם הבא. Now, why? Because they built a tower and they had bad intentions. But when you're going to read the Torah with you today, you will tell me, Rabbi, I don't understand what Hashem wants from them. What it says over here, listen. And they told to each other, let's build us Ir. What is Ir? A city. It's a mitzvah to build a city? Yes. Umigdal, in the middle of the city, we are going to make the Twin Towers. It's a problem? No problem. It brings business, it brings people are buying, selling, making money. Yeah. No problem. Yirat Shamayim. Veroshob HaShamayim, you have to make it like a sky scraper. Not fun, nothing wrong. Venaseh Lanu Shem, we have to make a statement. This is our tower, this is our city. And if somebody goes around, he's going to find the location. They didn't have GPS in this time. So we say, we make it over here. It's going to be like a lighthouse, like a tower that is going to show us a direction. Now tell me, what's the problem that it makes? To build a city, to make a tower? So we try to hear from the word, וראשו בשמיים, that they say שמיים, הקדוש ברוך הוא, something, it sounds... No, but skyscraper, it doesn't mean it's against הקדוש ברוך הוא, it's nothing, you know. This is what I say, and you say, you have to find it over here, you know. They want to build a city. Why not? Let's see what the Eben Ezra says. Ve'ele bonei ha-migdal, this building, the builders of the tower, lo yu tipshim. They were very intelligent people, say in the nice way. She'achshevu la'alot el ha-shamayim, they didn't want to go to heaven. And you say they were afraid from the flood, they were not afraid from the flood. כי נוח ובניו נשבעו להם, he said, Hashem told us they won't be flooded anymore. And it's written in the Torah that they wanted just to build a city and to settle over there. And to build a very high tower, שיהיה להם לאות ולשם ולתהילה לדעת מקומר ולהלוכים כרואי המקנה. The Eben Ezra says the same thing. I don't see the problem at the beginning. Then when Hashem is, by the punishment of the Hashem, we have to know what they really meant to do. The Or HaChaim הרב בנתר, he say like this, that he believes that they wanted to stay in one place in the world and leave the other world empty. And Hashem wanted them to be spread out, not to make the world like a desert. They want to make it like people to go from a city to a city. But still, it doesn't look like such a big sin. The problem was that I saw from the Mfarshim something like totally different. And this I would like to go to walk with you about this today. They say, let's build a city, let's build a land, let's call all the people together. And in order to be in a city or in a land or in a state, you have to create a code of laws to live. True? How do you make rules? By democracy, by the rich people, by the strong people. But somebody has to give to create a law, the law book of the city. The problem is when we see by how Hashem is treating them, is working with them. If everything was there, let's build. And let's build our own codex of laws and our own civilization. We say to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, thank you for being with us for many years and built everything. But we want now as a whole to make decision, and we want the people to follow it. But there's one problem, there is no Hashem inside. We believe in Hashem, we love Hashem, but we don't want Him to run our life. What?
They didn't have the Torah, they didn't have any mitzvah, they didn't have nothing. If they used to eat, they used to say, thank you, God, finish. What law, what code there was that so, became so...
So, for example, they want to make a law that you're allowed to smoke if you're over 20. If the Torah say you're not allowed to smoke, the age of 20 doesn't mean anything. But they want to make a law that you're allowed to buy alcohol in the restaurant if you're 21. But if you're not allowed in Judaism to drink alcohol if you're getting drunk and you're going to be, it doesn't matter, you can be 55 and still don't drink it. Oh, if there is a movie, they say if you're more above 18, you're allowed to see it. You can be 65 and don't see this movie because it's not for you. But you create a law. And the law makes you that after over 18, less than 17, after 21, you're allowed to do it. Based on what? Based on a decision by a group of people. Why it's so dangerous? Because if there is no a guidance of a divine power, eventually what will happen that individuals are going to determine what they want to do. And
the world was just created from you because after Noah, with new people, new everything.
I want to explain you again something that you have to know, Gabriel. Every time when there is a group of people, there is a natural leadership coming up and people are looking for guidance. In their time was much more dictatorship. When Nimrod was the head of the empire, Avraham Avinu told him, hey, who told you you are God? He wanted to kill him. And Avraham's brother was helpful to Nimrod. So in a way, the problem over here is a much deeper problem because on the surface, nothing against God. But down, it becomes very dangerous. And let's go deeper with you, another few levels.
One second, but Noach did the same thing though.
What?
Noach did the same thing. He said Noach didn't have kids for 500 years. Isn't that breaking a commandment or a guidance that God told him to have kids?
Again. You, again, you, I'm taking, today I'm talking with you about a national level. You ask me about individual. Forget about it today. I'm talking about the fear of moving or going by, is what they say, you know. A few years ago, not far away in the history, there was a very sick man. And he wrote a book. The book was Ideology of a Sick Man. And what was written there? That there is in the world a lot of races. But there is a good race. There is the supreme race. And there is the other races. And there are races which are risks to the world. It's called racism. And he created a whole ideology of a sick man. That if I was born to a German father, I have the right to live. But if I was born to a Jewish person or to a gypsy, or a black person or whatever, I lost the right to live. So at the beginning, everybody was laughing at him, a crazy person. And then he took a group of people and he created a certain laws. He created a city and a tower and a symbol and an eagle, and he gave them uniform, and he told them they have to put their hand in this position, and he showed them a lot of symbols and signs. And slowly, slowly, this group of not normal people, using a major financial crisis in the 30s, they took over in a democratic way the election in Germany in 1933. And in 6 years, they announced war against the world. And after 1 year, they created, let's go now to war by our ideology. What is our ideology? Jewish people. They didn't call the Jewish people to kill the Jewish people. They say, they're using the word, let's clean the world. Let's purify the world from all the negative. But what these people do, that doesn't mean doesn't make no sense. Who cares? Because the group, the state, makes this decision. When I was 17 years old, I took the airplane and I went to interview somebody that was a soldier in a Nazi camp. I was younger and I was more movable, and I say, tell me, how did you, as a smart person, he was a guard in a concentration camp. Why you did it? So he told me, Mr. Yehoshua, the party told us to do it. It was our Führer that told us to do it. And who can think about something else besides what he told us? So I told him, were you wrong? He said, I followed orders. And I was a good citizen. If you have problem, speak to them. You understand what's the problem over here? You want to create, not individual person, a group of sick people. You need one crazy person with wrong ideology. And you know how many people he killed, this person? Not as Jewish people, not as German people, not Russian people, American people, millions of millions, based on the most not normal, sick ideology. Now, after 60 years, another crazy person stood up and say, The Holocaust never took place. But there are still 200,000 people that they were children, they remember that they lost all their families. So they're lying. And he is using the same tactics. A national campaign, talks in the United Nations, and use all the thing, all kind of changing facts to do what? To prove it didn't happen. And you know what Hashem is saying in our parasha? Why it's so dangerous? Because people has the quality to follow. It's called stada. It's called like the herd. And they believe in this. And they believe in this. I told to many people that came to America from Uzbekistan, why you didn't come to why you didn't go to Israel and came to America? Say, my cousin came, my brother came, so I followed him. That's all. No ideology, no where is good and where is bad. He went, so I'm going too. Were you right or wrong? I don't know. Everybody was going.
Most of the people came out of Russia because of that.
Why not to Israel?
Some went to Israel and came to
America. A lot of people went to Israel.
And the opposite. No, I'm not saying they did wrong. I was wondering why did they do it.
What was the reason?
The reason was because everything you said, and it's enough. It's enough. So the fear was, if you give to these kind of people, if you give them the ability to lead without Hashem, you know what will happen? It can be talking about racing, talking about all kind of nonsense. And I give you another thing. For example, group of people gather together and they created a religion. Angels, so Michael, Gabriel, Michael, stories there, Chalomot, they create a religion. What's written in the religion? That if you are going to kill somebody who doesn't believe in what you say, you make a mitzvah, and if they kill you because of this, you make even a better mitzvah. Now, it's not just on the level of national thing, it's belief. And then you see somebody 18 years old, and you tell him, why you want to kill yourself, to make a self-suicide, why are you doing it? He say, it's by the name of God. You tell him, which God asked you to kill somebody else and kill yourself? Where it's written? You say, it's written. They took something, I don't know from where, and they created the whole ideology. Give another example to make it even more interesting. A group of Jewish people gathered 2,000 years ago, and they say, we saw angels and everything, and we have to change our religion. But we know there was Mahamad Har Sinai, Moshe Rabbeinu, Moshe Emet, Torato Emet. So Moshe Emet, Torato Emet. But we are going to add now we'll take all the restriction off. So you say, why? Because this is the will of God. So you tell them, but maybe you're wrong. You're not wrong, you're wrong. And then they created through a group of people, a kind of political power, and they perform a religion. Based on what? On a decision that nobody knows from where. But the problem is when it's become out of individuals and become a group of people, become stronger because we are following a very weak point in human being behavior to follow the masses. What can we do? This is the way to do it. When about 150 years ago, there was a new ideology in life to make the world one. One nation, one language, Esperanto, and they want to create the Soyuz of all the social states in the world. Communism talk about a world movement to free the world from the slavery and the dictatorship. They talk about the pyramid, they talk about the proletariat, talking about the rich people, poor people. The same Migdal Babel, the same concept. One land, one place in the world. In the middle, you're going to put the Krasna Ploshet, the Red Square, and people are going to speak the same thing, the national communism. The manifesto of the communist people took all over the world. And they created a society. No God to walk out, no rich people, everybody should be the same. In 1988, I was lucky to go to Soviet Union to visit Moscow with my wife, and somebody, the one who was our host, he took us in the morning to pray in the synagogue, and we really saw, a lot of people, we were very happy, they said, these are our people. And then at 9 o'clock, I saw all the limousines, the black one, going to the way to the Kremlin. So I say, who is they? Say, etas Luganash Narod. These are the slave of our, the servant of the people. So the world, the people went on subways, on the tramway over there in the 7 o'clock in the morning to work. At 9 o'clock, the servants came to the Kremlin. And this is what we call the Tower of Babylon. You create ideology. Everybody is even, everybody is equal. This is the way they did it. And when my grandfather, Alav HaShalom, he was a rich man, they come and told him, hey, you are Mr. Rich, you have 24 hours, either you're going to run away or you're going to kill you because you are against the party. He said, what did I do wrong? He said, you are rich, nobody can forgive you. And they took in money and they stole the money, you know. And this is what Eben Ezra says over there, and the Kli Yakar talks about it too. When Hashem was worried, when you give to a group of people to lead this kind of power, it's going to end with corruption. So it's in many levels, on many levels. What? The only thing that they are missing is everything is okay. The only thing is there has to be a divine guideline, what's right and what's wrong. Beyond human. For example, if in America now there is a big debate in New York to approve the same thing of marriages, it doesn't make it kosher if 100 people make vote because of the people. It doesn't make it, you cannot justify by opinion of people, so we say, you know, the majority rules. The majority rules in Judaism doesn't apply. Because majority can be wrong. And then what? But what you can say, it's democracy, this is what they decided. No. I told you, and we spoke about it a few minutes ago. If somebody in your age, Baruch Hashem, all of you are more than 17, 20. If you go to a movie theater, and you show your driver license, they allow you to go in. But the Shulchan Aruch tells you, don't go in. It's not a movie for you. But what you will tell me, by the law I'm okay. By the law of whom? Of the Babylon Tower. Which law? And this is something that is going to be a big separation between the Torah and between the world, because we cannot follow laws that go against our Torah. And it's a very big obstacle. It's a very big burden.
Well, no, this thing, whatever happened so many years ago, until today we still have the same thing.
Uh-huh.
Nothing changed really. Since then, if Hashem tried to stop them back there, again, different languages and everything like that, and thinking that it will change, that people will not be as a group, as
human being, Baruch Hashem, have tendency to repeat their mistakes. There's no doubt about it. One thing we gain from the Mabul, Hashem say, I will not destroy them. Let them go up. Ole bachio, ole klon shava. Pa'azor shude. Pa'yach shava klon shava ole. But what is the problem of the Babylon Tower? When you read the Torah, there is no problem. It looks so nice. Unity. Together. A big tower. We want to be one. We want to be united. We want to be together. Beautiful things. But very dangerous. one nation, indivisible, justice, freedom for all. Very strong statement. Babylon Tower, under God, but real God. Don't create a God, say, this is my God now. And this is something which, therefore, at the end of the parasha, in the last few psukim, Hashem gave us the medication. Who is this Avraham Avinu? What you will tell me? Rabbi, you can fight with the whole world. Who can fight with them? I am just one individual. What can I do? Shteyam Agudil. Avraham Avinu is coming to the history. One person. His father was Avodah Zarah. Everything was against him. And he said, no. If there is Hashem, I'm going to prove you. And he was fighting from 3 years old until he dies for the same concept, to prove that there is Hashem in the world. That there is Hashem in the world. And I made an accounting that today we're celebrating 3,822 years of the birthday of Avraham Avinu. And today most of the people of the world accept Avraham Avinu as their spiritual father. The Muslims, the Christians, the Jews, Abraham, Ibrahim. But how did he do it? He say, I will not accept if Nimrod, the king of my nation, appoint himself to be God. He said, I don't accept it. You can be a good man, you can be one powerful man, but you are not God. And I'm going to fight for this. This individual will make the change in this world. And we are Avraham Avinu descendant, all of us. How do we have the power? We do have the power. How do you know that Avraham won? Because tonight, Mosei Shabbat, in the Forest Hills, sitting many people together and learning the Torah of Moshe Rabbeinu. It means that Avraham Avinu won. He won the Nazis, and he won the Nebuchadnezzar, and he won the Nimrod, and he won the Palestinians, he won the Plishtim, and the Romans, and the Greeks. Because he had the power, giving to Hashem a certain power. And if somebody like Avraham Avinu is going to be, to fight, to show what is the right way, he gets so much Siyata Deshmaya from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, it's unbelievable. We cannot accept that because this is the law, I will not fight with this. My purpose is your purpose. לתקן עולם המלכות שדאי, to make the world under God. How the Torah says, under God, and how to make it happen. It's not easy, but it's possible. It doesn't happen overnight, but it's possible. We have to do it. One of the, I tell you something over here, maybe it's a bit politics, but I think there's meaning what I'm saying over here. There was a question about, and again, it's just an opinion, but it's connected to what we learned today, maybe to give us a different understanding. There is a big debate about the state of Israel. Because the state of Israel is not a religious state. The land of Israel is holy, but the state of Israel, not all the laws over there are going by the Shulchan Aruch. And there is a big debate about the state of Israel, not state of Israel. But I was thinking, let's say all of us, all the Jewish people from all the world, if they went to Israel now, or 20 years ago, or 60 years ago, or 70 years ago, what was the look of Eretz, of the state of Israel today? When you're going to have, from the Knesset of 120 members, 70% religious people, or 60. How it would look like? And maybe on the state level, the achievement is bigger, and the destruction is bigger. Because you don't make decision for one person, you make for the entire on the entire people, population. So when people say, oh, Israel is not so religious as we wanted, I will ask him, you can go over there. You are Jewish, you're going to be immediately a citizen. You can start to vote. Vote one of the religious parties. And you're going to make it stronger. 10,000 make it stronger. 50,000 make it even more stronger.
And again, start following the same way. How do you know this party is, although they're religious?
This, well, if it's ran by religious people, of course, we have the tendency to make arguments and argue, but at least we know that there is a certain guidance, more than the guidance of not religious. But unfortunately, sometimes by being passive on the national level, the damage is bigger.
So you say we have to act?
Of course. There was an election, even in a small scale, there was an election over here in Queens for the councilman. And a Bukharian, one of our members, was running for this. So there was a very, very important rabbi in our community, very religious, that he told to his student, don't go to vote, it's against the Torah. So I told him, where did you get it from? He said, it's not Jewish, it's not this. I told him, hey, you live over here. There is a chance that the councilman is going to help you. Where is the violation? So we have this tendency to isolate ourselves from the reality. Which is very...
Because we worry, we're afraid, most of the time.
You are afraid because we're
again, somebody dictates something and we follow and we end up somewhere completely else.
So the answer is not to vote?
The answer is to vote and to keep being worried. You keep being worried, no problem. If I worry, nothing happens. But the idea is how to think on a higher level, on a community level. On a special, over here, we have a problem with one of the restaurants over here in our community. With that we found something, they made a very big violation. Now, if it's going to be tomorrow an announcement that nobody allowed to go over there, if 20% of the people will not go over there, they are going to come to us and ask us to do tshuva. But if we'll say, hey, what can I do? I have already this, I invited people, and if we don't make it there, if we don't make it strong, and we try to find on our personal level, we can destroy any progress in our community. On a community level, you can think about yourself, but on a community level, it can be very, very damaging.
Question I have. So, you said that where we live, we gotta abide by the rules. Isn't that kind of mixes up with if we have our own rules?
No, what I mean, if go to the rules, if there is a rule not to cross a red light, you have to do it.
Still, but people...
Yeah, but there is a local rules that it's a part of v'nishmartem od l'nafshotechem, and it's good. Or you have to pay your taxes. Or you don't have to hide income.
Let's go to that, what they say.
No, I'm talking about these laws. But when it's come, but if somebody will tell you that we allow to, the two men or two women are going to get married, okay, if they say the law, I'm allowed to do it, this is what I refer, you're not allowed to do it. You get what I'm saying? Because if somebody has to, if somebody parked illegally has to pay a ticket, let them pay the ticket. This you have to follow. But if they are going to justify something which is not.
But all starts like that with small little things.
Of course.
Even with the parking ticket, the Babel, like you said, it wasn't built like.
No.
No. It started with something small.
No. What was the purpose of Babylon Tower? To create a society that make its own decision, and the unity.
Rules.
That's all. Nothing to do with God.
But every city does that.
No. The. To make a laws inside the city, nobody is against it. And we accept it in our Torah. We say it in the Torah, Dina de Malchuta Dina. We respect it. What I refer is to somebody can don't use, we should not use these laws to justify that he doesn't keep the Torah laws.
Okay.
This is what I say. But of course you have to follow the laws over here. There is a famous story about the Chafetz Chaim. The Chafetz Chaim, he bought a stamp to mail a letter. And his student came and told him, I'm going to this city, and I'm going to take the letter. So you're going to save the money. So the Chafetz Chaim, he took the stamp and he tore it off because he said, I don't want to steal the money from the government. It's because the real Gdolim understand, the real big rabbi understand how it's important to keep the laws of the city. But it should not be instead of the laws of the Torah. There was a big rabbi in America that was very strict about money. So somebody once gave him a silver cup as a gift. So he went to the store and he said, can you wait and see how much it costs? And he wrote. So he wrote over there, he got an income of $37.55 as an income based on this cup. Nobody is going to ask him about the cup that he got in a bar mitzvah as an income. But he said, I want to be 100% honest, which is not against the Torah. This is as one rabbi say, there is glad kosher and glad yosher. You have to be honest people too. But this is on the state level, on to keep the laws, but it should not never come instead of your beliefs. A Nazi could not tell me I'm innocent because I followed the orders of my leader to kill people. You have to use your own brain. We learn in the Torah, I'll finish with this, in Masechet Sanhedrin, we learn something. We're still fighting about, but there was interesting law. One of the punishments in the Torah was to give lashes. Makot. But if you give too many lashes, you might kill a person. So there was a question that the rabbi, which was had the experience in medicine, they say, this person, I give him 12 lashes and finished. He made, and they start to count, 1, 2, 3, but the one who made the lashes, he hit him 13 times instead of 12 times. And by the 13 times, he died. Wow. Now, it was a mistake of the judge who were counting wrongly. He count 11 twice. So the judge make a mistake, and the one who hit him made a mistake. Who is responsible?
The one who hit him.
The one who hit or the one who counted?
No, the one who hit.
Both of them.
Huh?
Judge. So, when we learn that the one who hit it, he is responsible. He cannot say, I was following order. It's not enough in Judaism.
It's easy.
You have to count to 12. It's your responsibility. Is the judge, never hide, they told me, I am free. This is exactly the concept of the Babylon, the Tower of Babylon. This is the law. What do you want from me? No. It's not the law. You have to follow what is right and what is wrong. And it doesn't mean to violate the law, but it means that you have to object, and when you have time to do it, you have to say it, that you are objecting this law, because this is against the world. This is against the Kadosh Baruch Hu. This week is the week of Rachel Imenu, and I would like to thank my daughter, Ruti, that she organized a very nice event for women that are going to happen in the night of Rachel Imenu Yuletide, which is going to be Tuesday night? Tuesday night, over here, in the third floor. There is a very interesting presentation for women by famous Rebbetzin from all over the world, and there is Rabbi Kamenetsky is talking. It's a gathering for Rachel Imenu, and I would like all the girls and all the ladies to come and to be part of this. And hopefully, Be'ezrat Hashem, Rachel Imenu will pray to us that soon all of us are going to go from one from for the to come to our reach the last destination in Yerushalayim in Beit HaMikdash, Mirabi Amin.